Hi, I'm Avlin and I'm an intern with Lexus and Company for the month of July. And today I'll be continuing my topic from the last video, which was about Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act 1956. So in today's video, I'll be discussing about de facto guardians, natural guardian, legal guardian, and I'll also be discussing about that which section particularly talks about de facto guardian. So moving firstly to the natural guardians, usually natural guardians, according to law, father is considered to be a natural guardian, but if father is not present, then mother is considered to be a natural guardian. And usually as far as the appointing a guardian is concerned, then always even by law, father is appointed to be the guardian. Okay. And then we have legal guardians. So legal guardians are not the natural guardian. They are basically the guardians which are appointed by law, and they are the guardians appointed by law, and they are not lawful guardians, because lawful guardian can be a teacher to whom we send our child to study. So that is also a lawful guardian. So if we talk about legal guardian, the guardian is particularly appointed by the court. Further, we have de facto guardian. So de facto guardian is neither a natural guardian nor a legal guardian. It is basically assumed to be a guardian. So he is basically assumed to be a guardian. He is alone playing that role, and he has been appointed by the court. Most of the personal laws do not recognize them. De facto guardians are not recognized in most of the laws. And de facto guardian has no power to deal with the property, but he is de facto guardians are not de-recognized guardians, the only restraint on the power of a de facto guardian is that he cannot deal with the property of the person for whom he has been appointed as a guardian. So if we talk about the provision which is dealing with the de facto guardian, that is section 11 of Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act 1956. So there has been a definition given regarding de facto guardian, and it has been defined by Mulla. Mulla says that a person may neither be appointed a legal guardian, neither be appointed as a legal guardian, nor a guardian appointed by the court, but must be a person who have voluntarily placed himself in the charge of a person and property of a minor. So such a person is called de facto guardian. Further, it was held by Madras High Court in Palani versus Vanjilikal case. It was held that a de facto guardian is one who is not a legal guardian, in the same that he is neither a natural guardian nor a testamentary guardian nor a court guardian, but who, being entrusted in the minor through a stranger, takes charge of the minor's property and person. So what are the prerequisites of a de facto guardian? So de facto guardian, to be a de facto guardian, some kind of course of conduct is necessary on the part of the person who is being declared as a de facto guardian. An isolated act of a person with regard to the minor's property does not make him a de facto guardian. So prior to 1956, the Act of 1956, the de facto guardian had the power to dispose of the property of the minor to deal with some kind of legal necessity or for the benefit of the minor. But after the enactment of the Act of 1956 and under Section 11, it was held that the de facto guardian cannot deal with the property of the minor. So we don't de-recognize the concept of de facto guardian, but only their right to deal with the property has not been recognized by the courts. Further, we have another concept of testamentary will, guardian by testamentary will. So in this, Anyone can be appointed as a testamentary guardian by making a will by the father of the child. So a father can either make mother the testamentary guardian, or and even mother can appoint anybody else to be the testamentary guardian of the child. So this was all about de facto guardians and natural guardians and legal guardians. So thank you so much.